everyone. I hope I can be heard all right. No, you can't. That always gets attention. Can you hear me now as this thing goes? All right. Good evening to all of you. I thought about this earlier, and with the Red Sox game being postponed tonight, we're the only show in town. So thank you all for being here, and welcome to the Groveland Candidates Night. My name is Ruth Race. I've introduced the evening before to honor the occasions for you. I live on Nichols Way, have been a resident of Groveland for 9 years. I am a member of the Topsfield-Boxford League of Women Voters, having joined that area league when we first moved up here in 1960. However, I've been in Groveland for 9 years now, so I feel very much a part of the Greater Haverhill League. I want to introduce you to the moderator for the evening, but before I do, I will remind you that the League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan organization that does not support or oppose any candidates. We do take action on various issues which we have studied and taken a consensus on. In order to maintain our nonpartisan atmosphere, we ask that you distribute no literature in this room. And we also ask you to refrain from applause until all the candidates of a certain group have finished. We would appreciate that. So now, I am pleased to introduce to you Stephanie Trainer. I think it said Eva Valentine on your letter, but Eva unfortunately is ill, and Stephanie has kindly said that she would step in. Stephanie is a member of the Andover, North Andover League, and also the State League's field service representative for all of the leagues on the North Shore and in the Merrimack Valley. So, with that ado, I will move around here and introduce you to Stephanie Trainer. Thank you for coming, I should say. Hope you like that. I am assured that next year we're having 4 microphones.
That's right. Thank you, Ruth. So thank you and good evening, and many thanks to the Greater Haverhill League for inviting me to serve as your moderator. I'm going to really try to talk loud because I don't necessarily talk loud normally. So, we hope that over the course of tonight's program, you will learn more about what the candidates running for local office hope to do for Groveland. Groveland's local elections will be held on Monday, May 5th. Voters will be choosing several candidates, many of whom are in uncontested races. The contested races are for the Housing Authority, with 2 candidates running for 1 5-year seat, Light Commissioner, with 2 candidates running for 1 3-year seat, and the Board of Selectmen, with 4 candidates running for 1 3-year seat. There will also be a question on the ballot to change from a 3-person to a 5-person Board of Selectmen. I'll start by explaining the procedures for this event, which each candidate did receive ahead of time. For the audience, if you could silence your cell phones, and this program is airing live and also being taped for rebroadcast on local cable channel 9, I believe it is. Mr. LaCorey is here taping for us. We request that you treat all candidates fairly and remain quiet throughout the forum, and as Ruth said, hold your applause until they finish their closing statements. When it's time for questions for the contested races, there will be question and answer time. And we ask that the questions pertain to the office and not be personal. And if your question is directed at a particular candidate, I will give the others an opportunity to answer as well. We've decided, since we have this microphone situation and the ones in the ceiling are not picking up your voices, if you do have a question, would you please come up here, and then I will hand the microphone to you. This way the audience at home will at least be able to hear it. So, for the candidates, I'll begin with the candidates in the contested races first. And we'll go in the order that the contested races are on the ballot. Everything is alphabetical. So the Housing Authority candidates will come up first. If both candidates are here for the Light Commissioner, that would be the next race to come up. And then we'll have the Board of Selectmen candidates come up to the table. Candidates will be seated in alphabetical order from left to right, which is how your names are on the ballot. candidates in the contested races will have 2 minutes for an opening statement, and this will be followed by the questions from the audience. We have, you'll have 2 minutes to answer every question, and I'll be rotating the order that those are answered so that you each have an opportunity to be first and last. Then those candidates will have 2 minutes for a closing statement. Now, I need to explain who our timer is this evening. And that is Carol Pelchat, the president of the Greater Haverhill League. And Carol is sitting there. You'll need to keep an eye on her. She will be holding up a card when you have a minute left on your two-minute answer. It'll be that color. And then when you have 30 seconds left, she will hold up an orange card. And then the time card, which is pink, that will be when you should wrap up what you're saying, and if you don't stop within a reasonable period of time, I'll say thank you and move on to the next candidate. I don't think we'll have a problem with that. So, and then 2 minutes for a closing statement, and that will be done in reverse order from the opening statements. For you uncontested candidates, if you're here, you'll be introduced, and you can come up and make a 3-minute statement about your office and any related issues. So the uncontested races on the ballot are for assessor, cemetery commissioner, health board, moderator, school committee, tree warden, and library trustee as well. So I will, without further ado, call up the two candidates for the Housing Authority. They are Jillian Nelson and F. John Osborne. If you could come up to the table. And it looks like you two will pass the microphone to each other as you.
Pulling over in the process.
So we're going to begin with Ms. Nelson, and you have 2 minutes for an opening statement.
Okay. My name is Jillian Nelson, and I have been serving on the board since June 4th, 2012.
Oh, you need to really hold it up to your mouth. Yeah.
And I started my interest in the board because I was very interested in the community and affordable housing in general, and I feel like I've a lot of progress on the board along with the members and the staff, and look to continue serving.
Thank you. Mr. Osborne.
Thank you for organizing this league session. I am John Osborne. I have been in the town of Groveland for 44 years. My children have come through the system, and I have been interested in senior issues for a long time. My wife, of course, was the director of the Council on Aging for 20 years. And of course, I absorbed some of that through numerous telephone calls, which I had to intercede. I'm also active with the Friends of the Council on Aging. I'm the treasurer of that small group. I have been interested, as I say, in the seniors for a long time. My interest, my experience goes back, as I say, for a long time. I served 2 years as on the Conservation Commission, and something like 5 years, 9 years, sorry, on the Board of Health, 15 years on the Water and Sewer Commissioner, I guess the commission, and I also was the chairman of the Well Pollution Committee, which essentially made a settlement with Valley Screw for $1 million. I was organizing that, and recently I have been the chairman of the Bagnall School Building Committee. You might be familiar with what's happening in the Bagnall School. It should be wrapped up this October, and so I will, since I'm retired, I do have an opportunity to work in the evenings or whenever. I'm interested in looking after Groveland's interests. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we'll move on to questions from the audience. And are there any questions for the candidates?
Go 49 Cherry Tree Lane. Thank you for running for office. Tell me, or tell us, if you will, please, what your expectations are for the office. Simple enough.
Mr. Osborne, you first.
Okay. Well, the first thing I'd like to see is that the state representative is actually available. At the present time, we have a board that is a 2-2 tied vote. So I think the state representative should be appointed at some point, so that needs to be pursued. The other thing is that I'm interested in is elderly housing. I think there should be more of it. However, it's a very difficult issue, quite complicated, and I think we need to relate to the Affordable Housing Committee in order to work something together.
Thank you, Ms. Nelson.
As far as going forward, I think that the Housing Authority has a lot more area to grow in as far as affordable housing along with elderly and disabled. And there's always, you know, room for more affordable housing or elderly housing. And with the help of the elderly committee, I think that that's the way that the board will be looking to go into.
Thank you. I will ask that everyone speak up. In fact, can you all hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, very good. So we have to talk this loud so that we really get it out there. So are there any other questions for these candidates? Okay, then I think we'll move on to closing statements. You do have 2 minutes, up to 2 minutes for a closing statement. And Mr. Osborne, you go first.
Okay, working for the Bagnall School Building Committee, I was essentially in charge of contract negotiations with the architects, the project manager group, and the water group that put in the water system. I have been involved in contract negotiations a long time, so these are the kinds of things that I can bring to bear on these kinds of projects. If we're going to get into some affordable housing at some time in the future, they're going to be needing some people who are somewhat experienced in these contract negotiations. I think I can be helpful in that regard.
Thank you, Ms. Nelson.
Being a resident of Groveland, a fairly new resident, I look to continue to serve my community and work on behalf of the board. One of the things I'd like to touch base on that I think that was a big contribution was the non-smoking rule that we put into place, the board along with the staff. And we really are working towards safe and healthy living and within the elderly and the state units that we have in town. So I just feel that we're working together and going in the right direction and look to continue doing so.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
Thank you. So now we will hear from, if both are here, the candidates for light commissioners. So I'd like to ask whether Mr. Rollins is in the audience.
Oh, he is mine.
Thank you very much. What we're going to do is, at the end of the candidates event, we are going to allow Mr. Wood to make a statement. So that's what we will be hearing from Mr. Wood at the end.
It won't be televised,
right? Right.
No, it will.
It will. Okay. That's fine. That's okay. Then it will be televised, but it will be at the end of the event, and I will make it clear that only one of the candidates is here, and it will be okay. So now I'm going to invite to the table the four candidates running for one three-year seat on the Board of Selectmen. So the candidates are William Dunn, Charles Harrislack, Richard Shaka, and Michael Wood. So you'll be sharing the microphone. So you will have 2 minutes for an opening statement, and Mr. Dunn, you'll be first.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the Women Legal Voters for having the forum tonight and all you participants to come out. I'd like to give you a little of my background. I've been married for 27 years to a beautiful woman, and she's my backbone. I have 2 children, one 22, my son Patrick. He's my partner in my business, and he's a hardworking guy. I have a daughter, 23 years old. She's a real brilliant RN local here to the Merrimack Valley Hospital. I've been self-employed for 32 years as a landscaper, starting out in Beverly, Massachusetts. I've lived in Groveland for 28 years, and I've loved it. My reasons for running is I love Groveland. I think I can bring my business background to Groveland, for it needs to be run like a business to succeed. I love a good challenge. I love working with people. I want to keep taxes down. I want to bring business to Groveland. I want to get the town boards running and working together. I want to make permitting more people friendly in town. I would like to bring the road study program back to Groveland. I'm hardworking, and I believe I can put my energy to help moving the town forward. I'm honest. I treat people how I want to be treated. I love finding common ground. I do not like controversy. I think these qualities would benefit the town of Groveland. Board served, Activities Committee, 1987 to now, Cemetery Commissioner for 2 terms, Business Downtown Groveland Planting Island Committee for 2 years, the Memorial Day Parade for 2 years, and I was a president in Naples, Maine of a 150 home association, which I was a board member for 2 terms and a president for 2 terms. My municipal experience is, in my business, I deal with town contracts all the time through bidding procedures. And again, like I said a minute ago, I was a president of association in Maine, in which I was in charge of the roads, beaches, well system, administration, homeowners problems, grading and snow contracts, and I dealt with the town of Naples. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Harrislack.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Chuck Harrislack. I'm a resident of Groveland at 94 Main Street. I've lived in Groveland for just 3 years in the Groveland area. I've worked in Essex County for 18 years, so I'm very familiar with the area, and I've worked for the same company there. I'm one of the newer people to Groveland, and so a lot of you don't know about me, so I just wanted to give a little family background. My folks reside in New Jersey. My dad's retired. He worked for Camden County. He was a civil engineer for 40 years. He worked there, and my mom still works in New Jersey. They're good people. They've been married for 45 years. I like to think that the apple doesn't fall far from the tree in that respect. I'm lucky enough to still have my grandmother. She's 93 years old. Have the highest respect for her. She gets out more than I do. She is a good woman. She recently had some surgery recently, and rushed down there with my children to go see her. I have kids in the system, 3 kids. I have 2 stepchildren in the system. I also have another 3 stepchildren that are out of the home. So I have a big plate, but I think it gives me a perspective on a lot of different issues and that a lot of different people have. My education is I've had an undergraduate education. I have a graduate degree as well. In business, I've had managerial experience, and I've worked as a manager, so I've hired people and had the unfortunate firing people. And also I'm involved in outside boards. I'm on a 9-person board that's a volunteer type of board, and I think that type of experience will be helpful to Groveland. I'm decisive, I have no agenda, I am fact-based, and I think I offer the voters of Groveland and the Groveland community a new perspective. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Shaka.
Hi, I'm Dick Shaka from Groveland on Salem Street.
You'll need to hold on.
I have to do this, okay. Brief history. I served on the Groveland School Committee for 12 years, Pawtucket School Committee 12 years, town clerk for 12 years, selectman for 12 years. I'm on the cemetery board right now, and I'm entering my 13th year. I taught school for 20 years, 5th grade. Groveland Little League, 88 for 20 years and active in St. Patrick's Church. Along with Bill, I agree that I think that the road study plan that we had put together years ago were to take care of every road each year in its sequence, and we need to get back to it so that our roads are all in good condition depending upon their condition. The other thing that I think that we need to do is I'm endorsing the five-man board, and I'd like to have forums with the public to come up with the best plan of how this five-man board will work efficiently for our government. And also, I'd like to see the seniors, and I'm one of them, get a senior home, a place where they can have their meals, they can have activities, and it will be ground level, and it's a place they can call home.
Thank you. Mr. Wood.
Can I stand? Is it all right to stand?
Well, you know, actually, since everyone else is sitting, yeah, thank you.
Just asking. So I thought I'd start off a little bit about myself, since word around town is nobody knows who I am, which could be a good thing or a bad thing, which is strange because I've lived here for over 30 years. So like I said, lived here for 30 years, went through the Pawtucket school system, graduated from Salem State University, the bachelor's in criminal justice, the minor in history, went to Arizona State University, earned a degree in master's degree in public administration, and that's really where my interest of government service and politics and working within the government space really took hold. Started last year with the Zoning Board of Approvals as an alternate. I was appointed there. It's coming up on a year's anniversary for that. Some of my interests are making government more user-friendly, more accessible, and definitely more efficient. Some of my key concerns, education, the taxes, the infrastructure, as was mentioned up here, and responsible spending. When I told people that I wanted to do this, the biggest question was why? Why do you want to get involved in local government? And as I said, the interest started many years ago. I just never had the opportunity to pursue it. I've been doing sales, mostly software sales, for the last 20 years. 8 of those last 20 years have been working within the federal space, working with the federal government, DOD, intelligence agency, civilian agency. So I've had experience in dealing with government. I'm not sure what the other motives are for the other candidates running. As for myself, I don't have a hidden agenda. I don't have an axe to grind. I wasn't wronged by a committee, and I'm on a warpath to change something. I'm just an average guy who wants to try and get involved with the local government.
Thank you. Now we'll move on to questions from the audience. So does anyone have a question for the candidates? Very good, if you wouldn't mind.
It's Jennifer O'Malley, Pandora Drive. I have a quick question. How will you incorporate some technology into the board? Can we use it for informing the public or doing something with it to bring us into the 21st century?
Right.
Thank you. And actually, Mr. Harrislack, we'll be rotating,
okay.
So Mr. Harrislack, you'll
stand now, though. Right?
Either you arrive.
You have 2 minutes.
Thank you for your question. I think we have a basis for some technology already. I think a lot of it, though, is being underutilized as far as transparency goes. If you visit our Groveland website and you go down there and you look for agendas and minutes and things like that, there's nothing there. You don't see what's going on. And for a lot of people, we have busy lives. There's a lot going on in our lives, and we need to have that quick type of update, and unfortunately you can't put so much of that information on our new red sign out there. So, you know, we like to be informed in our home. You know, the other thing is that I've seen in a lot of the boards, and in particular, you know, I've watched the zoning board and some other boards have different types binder that comes out here, a heavy binder. You know, so I was thinking something like Kindles. I mean, you could put the whole Groveland bylaws on a Kindle. If you have a question about something, check it out. And be able to interact with it, so much of that time isn't spent trying to look for things. That would make the process more efficient. And so, yeah, definitely there's opportunities for technology there.
Thank you. Mr. Shaka.
Having worked in the town hall, especially as town clerk in a very small office, and it's totally full now, and almost every office you walk in, there are boxes galore of paperwork. The safe is filled, you can't even get in there. So I think that we should go to some sort of a technology where everything is scanned in and coded by departments, where they can pull it up at any given time. And that would make it efficient for the departments as well as for the town, because it would be on their computer, or at least they'd have access to it. And the other thing that I think would which might work better, I don't know, it's an idea, that maybe we should have one person collecting all fees so that that is entered through the right process and other departments don't have to handle money. That's how I would start with some technology, and I'll stop here.
Thank you. Mr. Wood.
I actually like this question because I am in technology. So. I think what everyone's talking about, I think what Dick's talking about, is actually called a private cloud, which you can archive all your systems and have it accessible to every department based on different containers they're called. So that is a way to use current technology as far as hardware to expand its use and expand the actual usage of cloud technology with the existing systems. Now, it's not very expensive, it is efficient. But the good part about it is most of the software that the cloud runs on is free and open source. So as long as you have, call it a CTO, you know, a technology guy that understands open source and can use that software on the existing hardware, it should be something that's reasonably simple to stand up.
Thank you. And Mr. Dunn.
Well, unlike the other candidates, most people probably know me in town. I know nothing about communications. But what I would do is I would probably try and get the cable TV people to try and get what's on cable TV to come on a regular schedule. Our local cable guys, they do a great job and everything, but a lot of times if you go on TV to try and get our local government, you can't find it. Or it's on at 11 o'clock at night, 11:30. So I think what we need to try and do is just work with what we got. I really do not have the knowledge to sit there and try and explain anything new. And it's only because I'm not in that field. Thank you.
Thank you. So are there any other questions?
Yes.
My name is Inez Steele, and I live at 6 Union Street in Groveland. And my question for everybody briefly are, what two things do you see as major challenges facing Groveland that you would address in your term, and what is one thing that you think that is being handled well and is going well for Groveland now? Thank you.
Thank you. So I'll continue the rotation. Mr. Shaka, you first.
Two things that are positive or negative, or not quite sure.
Two things you would focus on, and then what's going well.
It was the question was two
well,
things
I guess
that
what
you
I
would
focus
on
is, as I said, on the five-man board. I'd like to have public forums. I'd like to have input from the public as to how they want this five-man board to be efficient. And I have my own ideas. I kind of threw out the idea in my own mind that maybe perhaps each board member could pick X number of departments they feel very comfortable dealing with. And if they wanted to be going to their meetings and they wanted them there, you could go there. Even if you didn't go there and they didn't need you, you could ask for different items of interest from them and money items that they may want somewhere down the line. Anyways, you would always get their minutes. And if I had five departments, I would make four copies of those and pass them on to my colleagues, and they would do the same. So so that everyone would still be knowledgeable about what's going on in all the departments.
Thank you. Mr. Wood.
So two things that I would focus on, as I kind of said earlier in my opening statement, areas of concern. I would focus on taxes. I know all of us have seen our taxes increase substantially in the last 5 to 10 years, those that have been here that long. And then responsible spending. At the town hall meeting, there was several issues that people were passionate about as far as spending large amounts of money that could have been directed towards other resources that may be more appropriate. As far as something along that has been going well, I think the education reform that Dr. McQueen has instituted up to about 2 years ago has been going well. I think that that has a long ways to go, and I think there's some action items that could be addressed there. But as far as the right track, I think it's on the right track, and I'd like to see the Pentucket school system return to the times when I was there, when I was proud to go there and it had a good education system. I think that it has a long ways to get to that point again. But I think Dr. McQueen has done a good job in getting us on the right track.
Thank you. And next, Mr. Dustin.
Okay. two things that I would focus on is, number one, taxes. I think since I've got here in 1986, roughly, that taxes have considerably gone up. I think we need in this town to learn to say no. Not no all the time, but no to try and keep things straight, to keep things in order, to keep things from getting out of order as far as overspending. I had a gentleman the other night when I was over at the Bagnell School come up to me. He says, "Bill, can I ask you a question?" I said, "Sure, go right ahead." He said, "Let me ask you a question about the Parks and Rec. Let me ask a couple quick questions." I said, "Sure, go right ahead." He says, "What do you think about the town in the bidding, like when they have the bidding? Do you think the town selectmen should be involved in the bidding of the fields and the scheduling of the fields?" I said, "No. I think what should happen is you people, your board, the rec board, should run the rec department 100%, bring your consensus to the board of selectmen, and we'll help you make a decision." So I think that's one avenue, is trying to make the boards all work back and forth together. And the other thing is, I think we have good in Groveland going for us, is I think we have a great new finance director, and we have a great finance committee board with our town. It's done very well and kept us in very good financial straits. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Harrislack.
Thank you for the question. The two areas that I see, that come to maybe needing improvement is some balance within some of our boards. Looking at zoning in particular, zoning is a balance between execution of law and then also enforcement of law. If those things aren't working equally, it makes it very difficult for either party to make the right type of decisions and to go forward with the right type of decisions. And it could hurt either of those groups because they might not make the decisions they normally would make or should make in accordance with the law, because they might be afraid the other enforcement division isn't going to execute what they need to execute. My general feeling about zoning are the questions you should be asking are where, what, when, how, and the who and why shouldn't really be a factor if it fits within our laws. The second item is personnel. There's been a number of things that I've seen Monday night and then also hearing some issues at the library that I just don't think should be happening. And I'm not sure, I'd like to get to the bottom of it. I'm not really sure at what level it's happening. All I know is I work for a company, I worked there for 18 years, and a lot of the things that I see going on, borderline is insubordinate in a way. There's something that needs to be done there. And I saw in reading some of the general bylaws, there was a personnel advisory board, and maybe that's something that needs to be looked at again. The thing that I see that's working, and I'm very happy about the open space, I think the way to handle some of these things in taxes might not be to cut spending, but to make Groveland more inviting, make people want to be here, make merchants want to come into town, and not just, different types of business. Business diversity is important, and open space is important. It'll make that flourish. It'll help home values go up. All of these things will help Groveland in the long term. Thank you.
Thank you. So you have a question?
Of course.
Very good.
Steve Merrill, Summer Street. My question is, and I think Bill just stole my thunder a little bit, but I'll add to it a little bit. Parks and Recreation, right now, we always have to go for field permitting to the selectmen. And that process is tying them down with other responsibilities, higher for responsibilities. And we have a recreation committee that doesn't have that responsibility. There's a lot of things like that that have happened that the selectmen are making decisions on that I think are small potato things that should be passed off to the boards. So I wanted to hear your opinions on that. You know, in particular, of course, the recreation side. I mean, how do you feel? Where should the job be going? Should it be still with the selectmen, or should it be with these boards and committees that we make up?
Thank you. So, Mr. Wood, you'll have first crack at this.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And that goes back to a little bit of my opening statement of being more efficient and accessible. Something like that, in order to be able to use the fields that are publicly available anyways, to have to go before the selectmen is a little bit overdone and redundant. Going back to just the board or the committee that handles that is much easier, much more efficient, much quicker, and can turn it around, you know, in a matter of days rather than waiting for the board selectmen to meet on that. So, yeah, I totally agree with it. That's overkill and not necessary.
Thank you. And you're going to have to pass it all the way down to Mr. Dunn.
I like standing. I'm really standing.
You got more
in your exercise.
I know.
As I stated a few minutes ago, I'm on board. I think that the selectmen should do the job that the selectmen have been voted to do. I don't really want to get into the issue that we've recently had with the fire department, but I, as a landscaper in town, would not want to have to hire a police chief or a fire chief in town. I do not believe it is my job. I do not have the knowledge to hire a police chief or a fire chief. I would like to sit there and put a board together or a committee together to hire the fire chief or the police chief. I think that what he had just mentioned about the Parks and Rec, I think what should happen is they're there. They're a committee. They're here to volunteer the time for town. Let them do their job. Let them. That's what they're there to do. Get going. Get a group of guys. Have a good time. Get the ball fields going. Get the schedule going. And come before the selectmen and say, hey, guys, we're here. We got a schedule. Can you work with us? You okay? That's what we're there for. We're not there to be bosses. We're not there to be, you know, we're not there to be dictators. We're there to work with the town. We're there to make the town an easy place to come and be part of and make it fun. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Harrison.
Thank you for your question. As far as the delegation of that to the recreation department, I totally agree for sporting events. Again, I would ground, you know, my other statement within the bylaws. As far as recreational events, which involve any types of consumption of alcohol and things like that, I think we have to defer to the bylaw. You know, where you're bringing something into a public place where the town has liability. And it's the selectman's job to protect the town in all ways. And I'm sure there's a lot of compromises that can be made in doing that, whether it be bringing in people in that are hired bartenders that are allowed to actually look at licenses or do whatever they need to do. But to not have permitting for those type of things versus sporting activities, I think you have to look at them separately. So I'm not sure if your question was involving both or not, but I wanted to address both.
That's a separate event.
That's all. Okay.
That's on the table. So.
All right. So that's all for the, but sporting, I believe it should be delegated.
Thank you, Mr. Shaka.
Well, I was on the activities committee as well as the towns committees, and frankly, I think the selectmen should allow these committees to manage the properties and the playing of the fields, and not the board of selectmen.
Thank you. So, are there any other questions? Very good. And then.
Thank you again, candidates. My name is Joe DeMore from 9 Cherry Tree Lane. There are folks in our town who have young children and have one income. There are folks in our town who are underemployed, some unemployed, and there are older folks on fixed incomes. I think one of the most fundamental things that we need to do as a community is that we need to grow our tax base. We need to get more people to pay taxes instead of the same people increasing taxes. Can you all share your perspective on how we can do that?
Thank you, Mr. Dunn.
Well, I think the biggest and the best way you can grow your tax base is to bring business to town. This town, as long as I've been here, has never been business friendly. I'm sorry to say, but I have a business in town, and we need to bring business. That's the best way you're going to help your tax far as making the people pay their taxes, all you can do is the banks, most people get the banks and what have you, and the new finance director, I've heard that, you know, that's going to be one of her jobs to collect the taxes and what have you, and hopefully she'll do her job in doing that. But I'm big on business. I'm big on business in town. I think business should come to town, and I honestly think that our schools are going to get stretched to the limits, and I think that we need to do is really stop taking a good look at our business in town. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harris.
Thank you for your question. The thoughts of the taxes and things like that and bringing business into town, I think it's important to bring business into town. I also think it's important to have a diversity and the right types of business. There's certain businesses that might already be paying taxes for their buildings and for their land already, and wouldn't be any contribution if they're all of a sudden being used for an inappropriate use. I think there's opportunity, again, you know, to make Groveland more inviting and actually raise some of those things as far as assessed value of the homes and the properties without increasing the tax rate and just increasing it that way. I think I mentioned that the Groveland taxes over the past 5 years have increased 30%, and the assessed home value has decreased by 10. In the last year alone, it's decreased by 6. So there's something going on here that needs to be remedied in another way. You know, what is happening in Groveland, and what do we need to do in order to bring that back up? So I think the idea is inviting communities and doing the right thing as far as, you know, bringing certain merchants into town and making people want to, you know, reduce their life radius, so to speak, and, you know, keep people close to town. I mean, how many people, I mean, you can't even shop in town. Right? You have to go out to Georgetown, down to Crosby's, or you have to go across the way to Market Basket. And there's a lot of conveniences as you start to bring a community in. From those type of conveniences, you actually help the community at large. And as far as residential developments, I think if it's done the right way, it could be done very well. Compact developments where you're preserving open space and having walking space and having not just a urban type of sprawl, there's a lot of benefits there as well. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shaka.
I actually really don't have an opinion on this because I'm seeing what's going on at Estes Lumber right now and houses going up for sale because it's going to have a mixed usage of both income, low-income housing, business, and homes are going up for sale right around it. I think we probably have to, I don't even know what land we have left that we can do in an industrial park because we've bought now Center Street for our aquifer protection. So I think we have to assess what we have left for land and whether that's advisable for business, and I would agree if it is, we should do it.
Thank you, Mr. Wood.
Some of those business concerns that were brought up are actually major topics that are at the zoning board, making it easier for people to either change permits or get permits to own a business and operate a business in town. So that goes back to the efficiency and making it easier to bring people in to open new businesses or to change what was there before as a pizza place and maybe make it a hair salon or something like that. So that's been something that's been discussed for, I think, months now on the zoning board and how to make that process easier. So that's one way to address the taxes. The other way that I see is to look at some of the either fully abandoned or partially abandoned houses that are in town. There's one on my street that no one lives in for 2 or 3 years. Apparently someone's paying the taxes on it, but it's still an eyesore. And I would say if they're not going to live there, then let's, you know, either repossess the house, fix it up and sell it and have someone pay higher taxes on it. You know, that's one way to see if we can increase revenue for the town and make it look better.
Thank you. So
we had a question. So I think this will be the final question.
Hi, Mark McCabe, 16 Bear Hill Road. I also have a local landscaping company. It's not called Dunn's either. And I got a question about taxes. I lost 2 customers over the last 2 years, and the reason was because of taxes. And I was wondering, that we have a CPA tax, which is 3%, and currently we have around $1.7 million in that CPA tax. I decided in the fall that I'm going to get a petition to eliminate the CPA tax for the next 5 years. If I did that, would you support it?
Thank you. Mr. Harislack, this goes to you first.
I would have to say no. You know, we've been paying the CPA tax right now. I think there could be potential where that could be used to increase the community and the quality of life in the community. I don't think we're going to see the benefit from removing a tax of that percentage. We just had a water and sewer increase 3% as well. I don't hear you talking about that. So I think there's certain things we need to look at, why certain taxes are increasing and why they aren't, and which ones are going to be the right ones for the community and to help strengthen and bolster the community. Because as Mr. Shaka said, I mean, we have some limitations of space. So now what do we do to the space that we have? We can only raise the value of it and try to bolster the community in that way. And I think that is going to be one of the means that's going to be necessary to make Groveland a more inviting place, a place where people want to live. They want to spend money. They want to spend their dollar. You know, if for anybody wanting to leave, Groveland and retire and go someplace else, to be able to get some additional value for their home if they've already invested quite a bit of money in. So, and that's what I'd like to see happen. You know, people that want to move and see new people come in, and just really see Groveland thrive.
Thank you, Mr. Shaka.
If elected, I would look into it and see what it amounts to, and then make a decision then.
Thank you, Mr. Wood.
I would say that I could possibly support that. It really depends on a couple of factors, right? One, where that money would go. Well, let's look at it this way. So that money is being used for some kind of service or some kind of spending, right? So where would that money be coming from in order to keep those services going if that tax is revoked?
The money right now is coming in mostly by open space. In the open space we're buying, we're now losing our revenue on the taxes on that open space. So
yes,
what I was asking for is maybe to release the burden off some of the taxpayers. People, like I talked to people at Whitestone who moved to Groveland, their taxes are, doubled.
Right.
And they have no kids in the school systems, no rubbish. And what they're asking me is, I was talking about it, maybe reducing the stopping for the next 5 years. 3%.
I could look at supporting that.
Thank you. So,
I think we've got.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, yes, Mr. Dunn. My apologies. Thank you all for being here.
Well, let me see if I can do this and go around the. The 3% tax, I believe, if the project or the land or the development they were going to put before us, if it made sense and we didn't have to increase the tax dollar to the taxpayers, I would support it. But if it's going to turn around and it's going to keep on making our taxes go up and up and up, I wouldn't support it. I've seen some projects come into Groveland where it's good. I've seen some projects come into Groveland where it's bad. So I think I'd be on the fence, but I would take a look at both avenues as far as if it's good or bad. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think we will wrap up this segment, so we'll be moving on to closing statements. So Mr. Wood will go first.
I still can't stand, right?
You have.
3 minutes. Or
3 minutes?
12 minutes.
Okay.
12 minutes.
Okay. I'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight. The League of Women Voters for setting this up. I know it takes time out of your busy schedule to come and ask us questions and kind of meet us. I look forward to serving the town of Groveland in whatever capacity you deem fit, whether it's for Board of Selectmen or even my current role as being an alternate on the Zoning Board of Appeals. I think it's time for Groveland to move forward with someone with a little bit different background, a different skill set, with motivation, energy, passion, and commitment to serve the people that live here. And I think I am that candidate.
Thank you, Mr. Shaka. You have 2 minutes.
2 minutes. I want to thank you for coming and asking the questions and being involved in our government. And if elected, I'm retired, and as usual, I will give it whatever it takes.
Thank you. Mr. Harislack.
I'd like to thank everyone. district's invested in my children, and so I believe in giving back. I again have a different perspective, a different skill set. I think I have the ability to bring a lot of things, from my past 18 years of experience. Again, I'm very involved. I'm an avid outdoor type of person. I know that economy brings a lot of dollars into places, and it's something that we all enjoy to do. And I like to see that continue. I like to see Groveland sort of evolve in that way. It's definitely a great place, a good place, and I would like to see it become great. And that is my goal for Groveland, and I ask you all for your votes and your support. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Mr. Dunn.
I'd again like to thank everyone for coming out tonight. As people in town get to know me, they're going to realize I say things in English, not Latin. I'm very simple-minded. If I'm elected, I will be very excited to work with the town employees and the town boards. I will not make promises I cannot keep, and I will work hard for you. Let's go out on May 5th and bring a new outlook to Groveland. Thank you. Thank you for coming out tonight.
I will now call up the candidates. I'm going to call up four of the uncontested candidates. We'll call you up four at a time. So, N. Dana Moody is running for assessor, if Mr. Moody is here. Okay. Nope. All right. Cemetery Commissioner Robert Guptill. No? The Health Board, Robert D. O'Hanley. Or Charlotte Parker. These are the uncontested candidates. Okay. Library Trustee, Lori LeBlanc, Laurel Pahalski, and Heidi Snyder. Are any of them here? Okay. S. Valerie Osborne is here. And is the candidate for school committee, the unopposed candidate, John Willett. Is John Willett here?
No.
Okay. Mark McCabe is running for tree warden. Mr. McCabe, is that? That's a different McCabe. Okay.
Same McCabe.
Same McCabe. So you'll have an opportunity to make a 3-minute statement. Do you? Oh, okay. Sure. You sure?
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about your office.
Put me on the web, huh?
Yeah. I know, right? And what about Bruce Adams for Water and Sewer Commissioner? So they're okay. Well. So then, Ms. Osborne, if you'd like to make a 3-minute statement, I would just ask everyone to quiet down. And
am I it?
You are it.
I'm feeling lonely out here. Good evening, everybody.
And there you are.
Thank you. Yes. Good evening. I'm Valerie Osborne. I'm your town moderator as of now. I've been the moderator since 2001. So I think I said I was a veteran. Is that the word they use?
That's
in the newspaper. The veteran moderator of Groveland. And some town meetings make you feel very old. but anyway, I thank everybody who came to the town meeting on Monday night. I'm running again for town moderator. My husband thinks I'm crazy. he says,
guilty.
Why do you do this to yourself? But both of us have always felt that it's really important to give back to your town. Those of you who don't know me, you can tell by my accent I wasn't born and bred here. But John and I have dual citizenship. We're both citizens of the United States and of Britain. So I'm hoping they never go to war, because we'll have a hard time choosing Britain again, right. So I have enjoyed being the moderator. It's sometimes a little tough when you have people who are on the floor and make it a little difficult to have a civil conversation. But I try very hard to have people be civil to each other. My main object when I first became moderator was to try and have town meetings that finished in one night. In the when we had the moderator before me and before that, we used to have town meetings that sometimes would go hours of one night, and then they'd have to be continued for hours for another night. I'm sure some of you sitting here will remember we'd have a 4-hour meeting which still didn't finish the work, and would have to go to another 4-hour meeting on another night. My main objective was to try and tighten things up, tighten things up, finish everything in 1 minute, and get off the stage. But that was my main objective, to have everything done in one evening, and ever since I became moderator, we have managed to do that with your help. Earlier we had a hard time getting 100 people for a quorum, but we had virtually 190 the other night, and that is owing to you people knowing how important it is to come to the open meeting type of town government. It's we're a dying breed. There aren't that many of us small towns left, and you are the people who make the town meeting, and you are the people who make it work. And thank you. I look forward to serving you again if you feel strongly enough to vote for me. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'd like to thank all the candidates for being with us this evening. I'm going to close the forum and then give Mr. Wood an opportunity to make a statement. He's also running for life commissioner, so yes. So, but Groveland's, your town election is Monday, May 5th, and the polls are open from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. at the town hall. This program will be rebroadcast. I believe it's on Channel 9. I'd like to thank Chris Licori for taping tonight's program for us. And I'd like to thank Carol Pelchat for being our timer, Ruth Race for being with us this evening, and Valerie Osborne for her help with this as well. It's been a pleasure serving as your moderator. And if you would indulge me for one more minute, I would like to invite Mr. Wood up to talk to you about why he wants to run for life commissioner.
Happy I get to stand for this one. This is it's a little bit more comfortable. So yes, I'm running for light commissioner too, and if you don't see me fit to be board of selectmen, maybe you'll see me fit to be light commissioner, and I can prove myself there. To be honest with you, I don't know a whole heck of a lot what the light commissioner does, but I'm willing to learn. I'm interested in doing the job, and that's it. Vote for Mike.
Very much. Kenneth Rollins is the other person running for that office. So now I will, he's not here. So I will officially close, and thank you all for coming. I hope you all vote.